Good morning.
Morning.
Let us worship the Lord all together here today. Let us worship the Lord in His presence as we pray. He'll be there to receive you, and His presence you'll enjoy. Be at peace with the Lord today.
Trinity Life Center in Madison Hillsdale,
and is expecting ladies from all over the district, and there's no charge, it's at 10 a.m. And so for the ladies that would like to go and be blessed, I know you will be, it's next Saturday in Trinity Life Center's at the corner of Madison and Hillsdale. Okay, so right off of Highway 80, so it's real easy to find, and pray for that, amen? Oh, we had a wonderful time at the craft feed last time. Yeah, good time, amen. God bless us, and even though the towel went out, before we got there, the people we were working with, yeah, we prayed it back on, amen.
Amen.
The people we were working with were so wonderful, though, even when the power went out, they said, "Don't worry, we have a generator for the food. Just go get some candles, and we'll serve you guys, and not carry the dinner." So, you know, it was just such a wonderful spirit last night, you know. And they wished me a nice happy birthday. I'm 49, I'm going to stay 49 for a few years. So, I wonder if we're at 39. Every time I told somebody I was 39, they were like, "Yeah, right, how old are you really?" And so I'm 49, and God has blessed me, and I'm so wonderfully honored to have so many precious, beautiful friends in my life.
Amen.
Family in my life. Well, let's worship the Lord. Let's, we're here to do that. And let's turn it over right now to our Voices of Victory. We'll catch up with the Parsha when Pastor Fonda arrives. They're a little bit slow this morning, trying to get our children off to the temporary job. Oh, yes, Pam.
Kim, I need somebody to watch the camera.
They're walking in the door right now.
Good time.
Oh, there's Pastor Fonda. Let's just welcome her now, because it's time for the Parsha.
He did the programs and everything. I just want to thank, and Sister Barbara had suggested the craft place to go and make it. Those people were awesome last night.
Oh,
and they want to come back. They want to do some work in the kitchen room. I want to thank the pastor because he don't have to do all this. He made us look like we were $1 million church down there. And the food was awesome. We had people come in and said, "I read your article and paper, and I want to make a donation. How much you want?" And I said, "Don't ever ask me that." But anyway, I want to thank Bobby, Joe, and Edward. They're always there. They're close as my phone is. I want to thank AJ and Terry. They're not there. Those are my faithful volunteers that come out and help set up. They brought tables from the church here and chairs from the church, and they set them up there and brought them back home. And I want to thank my husband.
Amen.
That's a yes man. I don't hear nothing else but yes.
Yes.
I ran him right into me. He slept real good too. So, I mean, you know, nobody had no rest until we get everything done. And I want to reiterate on my pastor. I call him for my love and my happy birthday. I want to thank Sister Barbara for that little shirt lady running around here. That lady really run. And how everything turned out. We had different ones from the community come and run the raffle and everything. I don't know what the finances was. The fact that we made a lot more than last year, so that's all I need to know. That's all I'm going to say. But I just thank the Lord for that. And Pastor Fonda for coming out. As a Pastor Fonda, I said, "Here, I can't carry this bag or the money bag."
No way.
So I'm just thankful for everybody that came out and all their help. And everybody said the food was delicious. And that's all that mattered. The food was delicious. The company was fun. And we had other churches that came and everything. And I'm just a happy camper today. And I just want a bowl of soup and I'm going to sit down. I can't do it. Thank you all so much. Thank you all so much.
Woo.
Yes, dear. My spiritual dad, the little Italian man, and his wife said, ah, there's only the best, sweetest words to my ears are, yes, dear. He was so sweet. He was a brilliant man. He ran the finances of California for a time. And he was a pilot, and he was a colonel, lieutenant colonel in the Air Force. And he was, you would never know when Inez was around that he had so many brains, because anything she said, it was just severe. But, you know, that made their marriage a happy one, and it worked for them. And my sons always said, I can't remember that message from my Uncle Vito. Say, yes, dear. So moving right along, I'm going to go back to the more serious things of the Parsha and Pekuda, I think. I'm gonna have to take Pekuda. Thank you, Pastor. The week of March 6, 2016 to March 12, 2016. The Torah readings from Exodus 38:21 to Exodus 40:38. The prophets, 1 Kings 7:51 to 1 Kings 8:21. The gospel, John 6:1-71. The glory and the tabernacle thought for the week. The paradox between the immanence of God and the transcendence of God. Paradox is illustrated in the mechanics of the tabernacle. The uncontainable and approachable God is somehow contained, so to speak, within and may be approached within a physical tabernacle on earth. The paradox between immanence and transcendence is also obvious in our sorry attempts to form a Christology which would explain the divine nature of Messiah. It is a mystery no less profound than the mystery of God taking up residence within the space of the tabernacle. It would seem to be an impossibility. Nonetheless, he did. A sudden shout rose up through the assembly, and all eyes were fixed upon the mountain. The cloud which had covered the top of the mountain these many days seemed to be descending. Yes, it was, rolling and cascading down the mountainside like a sudden avalanche of vapor, mist, and smoke. A panic spread through the people. A holy terror seized every heart, as if choreographed in advance. All Israel, every man, woman, and child, fell prostrate to the ground. There was a brilliant light emanating from the cloud as it dropped from the top of Mount Sinai. The peak of the mountain was now visible, gleaming in the sun. Without the cloud covering it, it seemed to be a small, humble, and insignificant mountain after all. The Lord had left Sinai. Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud had settled on it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Exodus 40:34-35. God had taken up residence in the tabernacle, but he was unapproachable. Even Moses, who was accustomed to standing upon Mount Sinai and basking in the glory of the presence of the Lord, could not enter. How is it then that Moses was able to withstand God's glory on Mount Sinai, yet it was not able to enter the tabernacle? When Moses ascended Sinai, he entered into the true tabernacle, the very courts of God. Thus, the glory of God on the mountain represents the glory of God in the world to come and the new covenant, whereas the glory of God in the tabernacle is his glory in this world and covenant. That is the reason Moses can approach on the mountain, but was unable to do so when the glory descends to the earth. The mountain symbolized the heavenly reality. Thus, even Yeshua had to veil his glory, except while on the mountain of transfiguration, a parallel to Sinai. His glory will only be fully revealed when the heavenly reality is fully realized on earth. In that day, God's people will be able to approach the glory without restriction. As John notes, I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb are its temple. And the city has no need of the sun or of the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God is illuminating it, and its lamp is the Lamb. Revelation 21:22-23.
I'll just kind of say, Sister Marie is going to come and lead us in worship. So, where is Sister Marie? There she is.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
As we prepare ourselves to worship the Lord, we're going to sing a few songs. We ask that you stand with us, clap with us, sing with us as we start our worship for the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Lord, you are worthy. So if you have a single book and you want prayer for this morning, pray for it. Pray with Pastor Fox. Come and be ministered to by the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. By our love, they'll know We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in the land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, and the we are Christians by our love. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity will one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. With each other we will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God has healed our land. And we'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, and know we are Christians.
We've been praying and calling forth 2 Chronicles 7:14.
Amen.
It's on the front of your bulletin. If my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, will I forgive their sins, and will I heal their land.
Amen.
We have a decision to make. What are we going to do about the destiny of this nation? What are we going to do about our children and our grandchildren? Are we going to turn from our wicked ways and seek the face of God? Not the world, the church. Is the church going to turn from our wicked ways and seek God? If the church will do that, this nation will experience revival.
Amen.
But if the church does not, this nation will go down the path of destruction. The Word of God says, I lay before you life and death, blessings and cursings. Choose life.
Amen.
As we begin and prepare ourselves to partake of the Lord's Supper, I want you to remember you are a set apart people.
Amen.
That means you're a holy people.
Yes.
And you're set apart for the purposes of God.
Yes. Yes.
And if you will humble yourselves
praise God.
And seek God's face.
Yes. Yes.
And turn from your wicked way.
Praise God.
Then he will hear from heaven.
Yes, Lord.
He will forgive your sins and my
yes,
sins.
Yes, Lord.
And he will heal our land. Do you want to see the greatest harvest in all of history start in the United States?
Hallelujah.
Or are we going to let it start in the third world because we are too prideful to humble ourselves and seek the righteous God?
Yes, Lord
Jesus. You see, he's going to work it out. The scriptures are going to be fulfilled either way.
Amen.
But we get to choose whether we want to be part of the great harvest
Amen.
Or whether we want to be part of the destruction.
Amen.
The church gets to decide.
Amen.
I go to the movies and sometimes I have to walk out because of the filth that they put on the
yes,
screen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen.
Do you know that's the church's fault?
Yes,
do you know the church had control of Hollywood, but because of their love of money, they gave it up?
Yes,
they didn't want to spend $50,000 a year to say what could come out of Hollywood. So they turned it over to the world, and look what we have now.
Yes.
Do we love God or do we love money?
Love God.
You're God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I know this isn't my usual pattern for receiving the Lord's Supper, but the Holy Spirit just came upon me and I wanted to share that with you today.
Hallelujah. Praise God.
For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus on the same night in which he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes.
Yes, amen.
Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. You see, the early church, remember, they were getting sick. And they were going house to house and they were saying they were partaking of the Lord's Supper. But instead they were taking it like common practice. They were drinking wine sometimes to get drunk, sometimes it was fermented. And they were taking the bread of the Lord and eating it like it was a snack. And God said, no. The apostle came and said, no. This is holy. This is not everyday food. For you to fulfill the lust of your flesh, to satisfy your need for food and drink. This is a holy covenant unto God. This is declaring you are a holy people unto a holy God. And you are set apart for his purposes alone.
Amen.
And we are instructed to examine ourselves. Father, come by your Holy Spirit.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
And show us anything that is not pleasing to you. For we are,
yes,
are mere human beings, men and women,
yes,
boys and girls. But you, O righteous God, show us all things. So,
yes,
Father, Lord, show us. Bring us to this place in this moment of repentance. Cleanse us of our sins by the blood of Jesus. We repent. We do not want to continue in those things that are sinful and not pleasing to you and that separate us from your presence. Let us be bathed in the blood of Jesus, clothed in his righteousness, and wearing robes white as snow that have been washed in the blood of the Lamb. I thank you now, Lord, and give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Now Jesus, Yeshua, he is a Jew. And he would have said, Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzi lachem min ha'aretz. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth the bread from the earth. Thus he is proclaiming his own resurrection, because he is the bread of life. And he rose from the dead on that resurrection Sunday. Let's partake of the body of the Lord. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant of my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. He would have said, Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam b'ri ha'chavetz. And say the English with me, blessed are you, Lord, our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. Who are you? You're the fruit of the vine. And you came to be the fruit of the vine, the blood of Jesus. Let's partake of the blood of Jesus. Let's sing a blood song. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, glory, praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus!
Jesus.
2016, the congregation of Victory Tabernacle, a family worship center, warmly embraces him and welcomes all of his gifts and talents for the use of building the kingdom of God through the Christian service and fellowship with one another. And it's signed by me. And you know, he's been working, even when he's not here, he's been working on the church building. So we appreciate you and help work with Brother Ray. And we you're now a member, whether you like it or not. So, this one, you know what, the Lord put him as a brother, Brother Bob, years ago with Pastor Shepherd, and he's been faithful to be there in season and out with Bob and Darlene, and I know some of the things you do, and I'll let you get your reward in heaven, but you're a faithful friend, and you're a good brother, and we see you enjoy our conversation, amen? Hallelujah. Now you sit down either here or there, because they're all gonna give you a hug when they come bring your offering. So we have to. So you can sit down somewhere. Sister Barbara, come on. You can sit right in the front for now.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You know, before I take the offering, I know that Sister Mary's always thanking everybody that helps serve her, but you know what? She's the neck that turns the head.
Amen. Amen.
You know, if it wasn't for her, we wouldn't really know what to do. But also, I wanted to tell you, I get phone calls from Pastor and I get phone calls from Sister Mary. And you know, they work like a team. I have never seen, you know, when I get calls, how they just are in sync with each other. But Sister Mary, I want to personally thank you.
Amen.
Not just for that, what you do, but you know, when I call her and if I'm discouraged, she just praise me and picks
me right up, and I just want
to thank you for being such a
wonderful,
blessed encourager. Okay, what time is it?
Offering time.
You know, I came upon the scripture, it was 2 Corinthians 9:7. But you know what? I read beyond, you know, sometimes when they tell you one scripture, sometimes the scripture after that might even be better than the one that the first one that they said read. So let, it was 2 Corinthians 9:7. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, the next verse says, and God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always, what is that word?
Always.
Having all sufficiency in said all things. He didn't say some things. He said all things. That just doesn't mean money. May have an abundance for every good work.
Amen.
So you want to remember, you know, I was reminded when I was sitting there what I was going to say for offering. You know how the little boys gave the Lord the 3 loaves and 2 fishes, and it served 5,000. But you know what? It served a more multitude than that. It was not just men that he served. He served the women and the children. That could be 2, 3 times, 4 times the amount that it quotes for the men. So, you know, as you give, it's your responsibility to give, but after you give, the Lord takes control. He multiplies it like he did the bread and the fishes. He multiplies everything we do as long as we do it for him. And as long as we don't do it begrudgingly, and we do it with our heart and our spirit, God is able to complete what is God is able to complete and finish what he has started.
Yes, he is.
And he has started this church and he's not finished with us.
Amen.
And you know, I counted 65 people here last Sunday. And you know, I know some of the people are probably not here today because of the weather. They thought, oh, it's going to be raining this morning. So they probably decided to sleep in. But you know, I called Jean, you know, Jean and John. And she was packing yesterday, so pray for her. She sounded a little bit weary. You know, moving is a hard thing to do. All right, let us stand. I've given you enough time to write your checks, do what you need to do. I just need to remind you that we also have capability of ATM. Don't forget that. And don't forget to shake, where do you go?
Brother Bill.
There he is. Get on. Don't forget to shake Brother Bill's hand and bring him into the leadership. You can't get out of it that easy. We all had to do it. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness to us. Thank you for the success last night. Thank you for as you speak to our hearts that you would just the work that you started in every one of us. Lord, you are capable, you are able, you are worthy. Oh, Lord, we just love you so much. And we know that you're going to do mighty, mighty things in our lives, in our church, in our pastors. Lord, we just thank you for each one. We thank you for our health that you've given us. Lord, we just can't thank you enough for all that you do. Each and every day, 24/7, you're there with us, walking right beside us, sometimes carrying us. And Lord, we just thank you for multiplying everything this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Do the Lord give his hand. Amen. Isn't that good all the time? Well, our dance team has a special dance for us today. So, unless you're in the dance, I'm going to ask that the Pastor Johnny come down there with us. But you come on down off the platform because their culture says they're not supposed to turn their back to their elders. So, let's come on down so they can get ready.
Oh,
We must get the vision to reach the lost.
Yeah.
Not just to come to church. Oh, I've already done all of that. No! The time is now.
Yeah.
Today is the day of salvation.
Yeah.
And the word says, I told Brother Ray this, prophesied earlier, the latter house shall be greater than the former. And that's what the word says. The latter house shall be greater than the former. Amen?
Praise God.
Sister Mary Lou, she thought one time she was going to hang up her sneakers. But the Lord said, no, get it down. I'm going to use you to teach still.
Praise God.
Keep using you. And so she took them down. I'm saying using sneakers symbolically. But every one of them, Sister Mary Watts, I told her I was going to throw her a retirement party, but every time I get ready to, the Lord puts her back into action. She always says, I'm going to retire. Anyway, do you want to see this neighborhood saved?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, I think this is better. Yeah. Do you want to see this neighborhood saved?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let us pray. Father, we just give you glory. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you all of us. Because you are worthy of all adoration and praise.
Yes, Lord.
You are worthy. What your spirit spoke to Pastor Edwards is true. The fight is fixed. You've already won the battle.
Yes, Lord.
All we have to do is walk in
that. Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And so, Father, as I begin to teach today, or preach, however your Holy Spirit would move upon me,
yes,
Father, I ask that only your word will come forth, that I would decrease, you would increase.
Amen.
Let us all have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Hallelujah.
Let us be in one mind, one body, one spirit, Father.
Yes, Lord.
And we ask that you would fulfill your word in us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise God.
I don't do a whole lot of this type of teaching or this type of preaching, but this is what the Lord gave me this morning. And there was I was waiting on him. In fact, last night, as well, I sat there in the chair after the crab tree. We got done with crab tree about 10 or 11.
Prettier.
And so I got home about 9 o'clock, and I sat there with my laptop on my lap. I turned the television off, and I was singing a few praise songs, and I was trying to worship and figure out what today was going to look like and everybody's schedules, because my young men that live in my house have a temporary job, and some of them were working this morning, and some were working this afternoon, and we're just trying to put it all together, you know. And then I was trying to get still in the presence of the Lord, and as I was sitting there, Pastor Edwards, he sent me a greeting on my Facebook message book, and I said, you know what, Pastor? I said, thank you. I said, what's the Holy Spirit speaking to you? Because I'm trying to quiet myself in the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
And to get what His Spirit is saying. And He told me, and He sent over His message, you know, the fight is fixed. And, oh, it's a great message, you know, and I thought, I could preach that, but you see, that's not how God usually moves on me.
No,
he usually says, That was a good word, Brother Cleo, but it wasn't the word for this house today.
Yes, amen.
I mean, it was something good to reference. It keeps coming back to me, you know, something to think about. God did win the battle already. The fight is fixed, you know. We don't war against flesh and blood, but against principalities in high places, and we know that Jesus did win the battle. But as I was thinking about all of this, you know, I just didn't have a word. Many of you don't realize this, that Kevin does, because he's a planner. He likes to do things in advance. And I get it to where he moved into a sinful area complaining because he wanted my messages, you know, a day or two early. And I can't do it, brother, because that's not the type of pastor I am. Now, some pastors are like that. Some pastors can plan a whole year of sermons. And God can be in that. It's just not the way he moves on me. That's not the way he moves on me. He moves on me right now.
Yes, amen.
And he has a word for today. And so I was saying, Lord, what is that word? Well, whatever time I decided to go to bed, I still had nothing. And I went to go to bed, and then the Lord started speaking to me. And so I sat up, But it wasn't a word for me. It was a prophetic word for one of my friends. And so I said, okay. So I had to start, I picked up my phone, because while the Lord was speaking it to me, I wanted to send her an email. What a wonderful age you live in, you know? And so, because he wouldn't let me go to sleep. I thought, oh, I'll tell her that tomorrow. And the Lord said, no, you'll tell her that tonight. And I'm like, oh, hey, fine. I'll tell her that tonight. So I said, well, it's good to hear your voice. Are you going to give me my message now? So after I sent the email off, he said, okay, go to sleep. I said, all right. So I woke up this morning, and I turned on my worship music. I overslept. I sent Sister Barbara a text that said, pray for me. But I get everything done this morning, because I got to even go to the bank before church today and drop off Caleb at work, although I delegated that one. And he worked it all out. And as I was sitting there, after I got my coffee and sat down, the Lord just spoke Colossians. So I went to Colossians. This is how your pastor studies. So I went to Colossians. And as I started reading Colossians 1, he said, no, chapter 3. I said, okay, fine. So here we are.
Praise the Lord.
We're at Colossians.
Praise the Lord.
Chapter 3. Now, you know, as a rule, I like to teach out of the King James because I feel like it's the Bible. That they didn't speak King James in the days of Christ. They spoke in Aramaic and Hebrew and Greek. But I feel that the King James, number one, is the only version that's not copyrighted, so nobody's making money off of the Word of God. It's just going for free, you know? And the other translations, they all have some things that are wrong, but they can be helpful. And so today I'm going to jump back and forth, because we're just going to, we're going to go through chapter 3, the whole chapter, and I wanted to talk in plain English in some places, you know?
All right.
And so I'm going to use a translation I'm not really that fond of, to be honest.
Praise God.
For study purposes. But I am fond to use it to try to take the word that was written thousands of years ago and put it in today's language, you know. So I'm going to be going back and forth. The Message Bible that I'm going to use sometimes I look at it as more of an explanation than actual scripture. King James we can trust. Alright? You know King James we can trust it. So, let's look at Colossians chapter 3. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek the things above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth.
Alright.
That's why I entitled the message above.
Yes.
Do you understand that all that matters is what really comes after this life?
Yes, amen.
Right.
You know, as Pastor Lane also used to always tell us, all the rest is just hay and stubble.
That's right.
All the rest is hay and stubble. He said the only thing that's going to ever matter is what lasts 1 second into eternity. After you've drawn your last breath on this side and you've entered the other side of this life, the only thing that's going to matter are the things of God that last. Amen?
Amen.
You know, there was a rich man, and he agreed to marry this really, really poor lady. She just sat on his feet all the time, and she said, you know, I'd make a really good wife. And he said, yeah, I know, you just want all my money. And she said, and he said, well, I'm really pretty and I make a really good wife. I'm just really poor, though. I need you to marry me pretty soon. I make a really good wife. I'll serve you all the days of your life. And the man said, well, I'll take your Boaz and I'll take you in. So he marries this woman, and he kind of grows to love her over the years. And she kept her word. She's a really, really good wife. He's really, really, really wealthy, you know. But he wasn't quite sure she really loved him for who he was. So
all right, now.
He called a meeting with his attorney, and he had his will changed. And so he asked her, do you want to see what I changed my will to? She said, no, I'm fine. And he said, okay. And she just kept on loving him and serving him all the rest of the days of his life. And when he was laying on his deathbed, he realized she had been really true to him. And he said, oh, I should change my will before I die. And then he drew his last breath. So they go to the reading of the will before the funeral, and it says, he stipulated that he wanted all of his money to be buried with him.
My
Lord Jesus. My Lord. And she said, really? Yeah, I want to bury all my money with him. So they filled up his coffin. They got to get an extra big one. Put all the money all around him. They had the funeral service, and his widow was sitting there. And the stipulation was, as long as they buried him with all of his money, his widow could have his house. And enough money to take care of the taxes every year. All the rest is going to a fund. So they were sitting there and watching. They're burying them, had the service, and she was really good. Right at the end, she stood up and says, hold up, boys! They said, what are you doing? She says, I'm following the conditions of this will. This casket's going to be too heavy, so here, come on in here. I want you to take all that money out and stick it over there. Just go put it in the bank. And he said, but that's going to violate the conditions of the will. And she said, oh, that's okay. No. I'm going to write a check. She put a check in there with it and took all the money, right? Illustrating the point, you can't take it with you.
Yeah.
You can't take it with you.
Amen.
It's all God's. Everything he gives us is for him, it's for his use.
Amen.
So let's look at things here. In the message you read, so if you're serious about living this new resurrection life with Christ, act like it.
All right.
Pursue the things over which Christ presides. Don't shuffle along, eyes to the ground, absorbed with the things right in front of you. Look up. And be alert to what is going on around Christ. That's where the action is.
Yes.
See things from his perspective. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Look up. Amen? Look at where is Christ right now?
He's right there.
Where is he? He's right here. But where is his physical presence besides right here? Because we know he's omnipresent. At the right hand of God. Amen. Where are we supposed to be looking towards? The right hand of God. Amen.
Amen.
And then where he is, we will be also. Correct?
Yes. Amen.
For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory.
Amen.
You see, let's say it another way. Your old life is dead. Your new life, which is your real life, even though it's invisible to the spectators,
all right,
now. Is with Christ in God.
Yeah, amen.
He, that's Jesus,
yeah.
Is your life. When Christ, your real life, remember, shows up again on this earth, you'll show up too. The real you. The glorious you.
Hallelujah.
Meanwhile, be content with obscurity like Christ.
Yes.
You see, this is what we're looking for. Where are you going to be? Looking at this picture, yes. Where are you going to be? Are you going to be with the saints of God? Riding behind Jesus who's on the white horse?
Yes.
Or are you going to be with the dreadful left on earth that are cursing God and are having his wrath poured out upon them? Today is the day of salvation. Choose this day who you will serve.
Hallelujah.
Keep your eyes on things above.
Yeah.
Not on things below.
Amen.
For you are of God.
Yeah.
Not of the devil.
Amen.
if you are God's act like it.
Amen, praise God.
If you're his children, be worthy of that calling.
Yeah.
Walk on this earth as if you are truly a child of God.
Praise God, praise God. Amen.
Know who you are.
Yeah.
Know your position.
Hallelujah.
Know your right. Which is to be alive in Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
And to experience every promise in the book.
Praise God, praise God.
Pray that your name is written in the Lamb's book of life and not blotted out.
Hallelujah.
And behave in a manner
Jesus.
That is worthy of a child of the Most High God.
Man, praise the Lord.
You know, we get these terms in our head, and we hear them so often, that they just become terms. We call it Christianese. Oh, bless you, brother, sister. Oh, I love you with the love of the Lord. May the grace that is in Christ Jesus also be in you. You know, oh, I'm born again, I'm born of the Spirit. But let's get past the Christianese, and let's put it into real life action. Let's keep it into everyday action and live worthy of the high calling of Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. It's hard to preach without the message on the screen.
And I can't help it.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The team is, we got to get this worked out. I can't have my notes going blank in the middle of the sermon every week.
I know.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Praise
the Lord. Hallelujah. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. Fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, that means greed. I looked that one up today. That means greed. Being it for you.
Yes.
I think we've all been there at some point.
Yes.
I was talking to someone earlier this week who said,
amen.
Don't worry about money, Pastor, because God's got to take care of. I used to be there where I was always worrying about money.
Praise God, praise
money,
God.
Money. But you know what? We can't be in it for that. That's a good word.
Man, praise God.
We can't be in it for money.
Man.
You know, I got to tell you something. The body of Christ, we do need to repent in a lot of high places in the church. Unfortunately, when you grow up in ministry, you get behind the scenes a lot of places.
Man.
And it almost runs you away from ministry when you see how some pastors behave.
Yeah.
They're wolves in sheep's clothing.
Praise the Lord.
Yes, they are.
And I pray I never, ever follow in the footsteps of those false teachers or preachers.
My Lord Jesus, my Lord.
Right.
Greed. Because of these, wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience, in which ye also walked when ye lived in them. Besides, you have covetousness, which is idolatry. In the which ye shall also walk sometime, when ye lived in them. But now ye also put off all of these.
Yes.
Anger. Wrath. Malice. Blasphemy. Filthy communication out of your mouth. Let's go to the message and let's see what it says about that. It says, and that means killing off everything connected with that way of death. Okay, let's just pause here for a minute. I know we cannot be perfect, for only Christ is perfect. But we can keep trying.
Yes.
We can keep repenting. We can keep asking the Holy Spirit to empower us.
Yes,
and we can get up and move forward when we fall.
Amen.
I was talking to a young man who's really striving to serve God and to walk perfect before Him. And I said, that's the way God wants you to walk.
Yes.
Just know that if and when you fail, God, He's going to love you the same amount.
Yes.
I don't want you to forget that. Because if you, sometimes we get carried away in our own might, in our own power, in our own strength. In ourselves.
Yes, Lord.
And when we start getting carried up in the rules and the regulations and ourselves, then we get tired or we get weak or sometimes a temptation comes upon us and we can fall.
Yes.
But as long as we realize it's not by might nor by power, but by the Holy Spirit,
yes,
says the Lord, we can overcome.
Yes, we can.
So we should. There are things on this list I once walked in. And praise God, He has delivered me. You should look at this list. And you should say the same thing as me. There are things I used to do, but because of the power of the resurrected Savior and His indwelling presence of His Holy Spirit living in me, I no longer walk after these ways.
Praise God.
So it means we should kill off everything connected with that way of death. Sexual promiscuity doesn't need any explanation, does it?
No.
Impurity, lust, doing whatever you feel like, whenever you feel like it, and grabbing whatever attracts your fancy.
Yes, Lord.
That's a life shaped by things and feelings instead of by God. You see, we don't only serve God when it makes us happy. We don't only serve God when we have plenty of money in the bank and the food's on the table and the bills are all paid.
All right, yeah.
And we have a spouse that we love. We have to serve God no matter what.
Yeah.
We've got to thank God for the good times and we've got to thank God for the bad times.
Yes.
We got to realize that our life is hidden in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
And that He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. He will never walk away from us. And even when we lose our faith, even when we walk the wrong direction, He's there to pick us up.
Yes, He is. Yes, He is.
He's faithful and He's just. And He will forgive us all of our sins. We just must ask. Jesus said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Amen.
Do not forget that we need to walk and live a life of repentance.
Yes.
I said to my mother, Pastor Fonda, recently, sometimes when I think about death, I feel like a hypocrite. I'm a man of God. I preach. I teach the word of God. I talk about heaven. I talk about coming back. But every once in a while, Pastor Johnny, when I think about death, I start to have a panic anxiety attack.
My Lord Jesus.
And I hear the thoughts of Satan. Yeah, there's no God. There's no, this is it.
My Lord Jesus.
You heard it too. I know you have.
Yes.
Because the devil's a liar.
Yes, he is.
And he's telling me those things he's trying to tell you.
Yes.
Right.
And praise God.
They're lies from the pit of hell.
Yes.
I said, I thought by now, after being a pastor, I've been ordained a lot longer than I've been the senior pastor. I'm going on 20 years of being an ordained minister of God. You would think I would have grown past that.
Man.
But you see, I'm still in my flesh.
Yes.
And the devil still comes and he tries to tempt me. The devil, he still comes and he tries to lie to me. Because the devil knows that he can take me out.
Yes.
He can cause me to lose my hope. If he can cause me to lose my faith, I'll quit preaching and teaching the word of God, and you'll quit receiving it, and there'll be one less person, and there'll be one less church, and there'll be one less people to proclaim the goodness and the deeds of the Lord. So I've got to say, Satan, get thee behind me. Because I am a child of God. His word is true. I believe it. And I'm worthy of it. Yes. And amen. In Christ Jesus. I've got to stir it up with the gifts. The immortal.
Yes.
Right.
Amen. Praise God.
I said, I thought by now, Mom, I'd be one of those holy men filled with faith, and I wouldn't have to wrestle with this old flesh every day. Why is it I don't ever hear other pastors talking about that? I feel like a hypocrite. Not because I'm living sinful, but because I have moments when the devil comes to me and tries to discourage me. Or I have moments when I lack the faith to believe God's going to supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. Or the times when I'm concerned that my children are not at church yet and they're driving on a wet freeway. And I'm thinking, oh, I just can't stand it if the police come in here and tell me my kids have been in a wreck and they're dead. But guess what?
Hallelujah.
I've got to trust the God of all creation. That his promises are true. Yeah. That his promises are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. I gotta trust the things that he's told me, that all of my children have been sealed unto the day of salvation. Hallelujah. I gotta trust that I can pray for his angels to camp round and about them and take care of them. But I'm also gonna trust that should he choose in his sovereignty to call one of them home,
my Lord, yes,
that I'm gonna serve him anyway.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to serve it anyway.
Yes.
A lot of parents outlive their children. I don't want to be one of them.
Yeah.
I only remember, I haven't experienced it, but I remember Brother Cleo after Vicky passed. And the conversation we had, which will stay confidential.
All right now.
But I just remember thinking that's got to be one of the hardest things on earth to face.
Yes. Oh.
But guess what? He was in his pulpit last week preaching and teaching the Word of God. Even when the scriptures weren't on the screen, he was preaching and teaching the Word of God. Amen? We got to keep going on. We got to keep trusting Christ Jesus. We have to keep proclaiming his Word because his Word is true. It is life. It's life everlasting. It's going to bring us everlasting life. And it's going to dwell in us for all of eternity. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
It is because of this kind of thing that God is about to explode in anger. It wasn't long ago that you were doing all that stuff and not knowing any better. But I feel like this is, in the message, it's just like someone talking to little preschool children. And sometimes I feel like in the Church of Jesus Christ, we're all in preschool again. Because we have been taught not to do the things that we still do. You know better now, so make sure it's all gone for good. Your bad temper, your irritability, your meanness, your profanity, and your dirty talk.
All right now.
You know what? I have heard every single thing that was just mentioned and seen it out of the mouth of other Christians.
Yeah, my Lord Jesus.
And I'm not saying I haven't either. I'm just saying these things should not be. Blessing and cursing should not come out of the same mouth.
Yeah,
right? But when we fail, we have to get up and say, that's not the standard. I'm not comparing it to myself. I'm comparing it to God.
Man.
I'm comparing, my standard is God. I know better. I hear to say, let's encourage one another in love. I don't want to get into a legalistic, condemning thing with people. I don't want, oh, I'm better than you. I don't say that dirty word. No! No! If that's what you're getting out of this, you're missing the point.
Amen.
Each of us has a responsibility.
Yes.
To live as though we are children of God.
Amen.
How many of you here have children or grandchildren?
Hallelujah.
When they go somewhere, don't you want them to behave? When they were little, when you went to a restaurant, didn't you want your children to behave?
Yes.
You don't want to be proud of them? When they were young men or women, didn't you tell them, remember what name you're wearing? You're wearing my name.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
You're known as Timothy Hinkle.
Yeah.
You're known as Jacob Hinkle. You're known as Matthew Hinkle. You're known as Ariana Hinkle. You're wearing my name. And not only my name, but my mom's name, my dad's name. When you go out and walk around people, I want my name to be honored. And I want to honor my parents. I want to honor their name. Do you know when you say you are a Christian, you are wearing the name of Christ? He wants you to walk worthy of his name. Now, although you might fail, he wants you to give up and try to walk worthy of it. When you were out with your kids when they were little, they do something like knock a soda all over the place or something crazy, you know, because they were acting up. But then they would say, oh, I'm sorry, I'm not going to do that anymore, Dad. That, you know, all of a sudden that anger or that frustration with them subsides.
Yeah.
You know, it's your right hand. Can you have, it's okay, it was an accident. We're going to clean. Don't you think God is even more gracious towards you?
Yes, he is.
I know he is towards me, or if I've been a Christian critter a long time ago. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds, and I put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond, nor free, but Christ is all and all in all. In the Message, let's look at this. Don't lie to one another.
Praise God.
You're done with that old lie.
Yes, amen.
I had somebody that was a brand new Christian say, oh, everybody lies. You have to lie to make people think you're better than you are. I said, no, you don't.
All right.
We don't have to lie to one another. We can be ourselves, good or bad, you know, and then we ask the Lord to forgive us and help us, and we ask our brothers and sisters of Christ to pray for us, and we go along, and we can lift each other up, and we can, you know, I was getting on to one of the boys this morning for sleeping a little bit late than they should have, but then, you know, the Holy Spirit says, make sure you don't leave it there, you know, and so I said, a few minutes later, before I was walking out the door, I said, you know what? I'm proud of you.
Yes.
I'm proud of who you are. I'm proud of what you're doing. You need to work on this whole area, yes, but I'm proud of you. Be strong and a good Christian. Not only am I proud of you, I know God's proud of you.
Yes, indeed.
That's more important than whether I'm proud of you.
Amen.
Encourage one another. Yes. Teach. But encourage.
Man.
When you see somebody doing something right, tell them that too.
Yeah.
You know that old style of parenting? You know where you only tell your kids when they mess up, they're never good enough, they never measure up, they're always a rotten little demon and you want them to go out playing the freeway? You know. That's not how God is to us.
Amen.
He tells us when we do well too. You know when you're in praise and you're in worship and you feel his presence? And it makes you happy all inside and all over. And some of us tingle, some of us shout, some of us jump up and down. You know that feeling? That's just God saying he's pleased with you. Yeah. That's not you. That's God. He's saying, hey, enter in. I'm gonna let you see how my joy is over you.
Yeah.
I'm dancing over you. I'm singing over you. I'm praying. I'm proud of you, son. I'm proud of you, daughter.
Yeah.
Now you're dressed in a new wardrobe. Every item of your new way of life is custom made by the Creator with his label on it. You ever seen these red carpet events?
Oh, yeah.
And they say, Jennifer Aniston, what are you wearing? And she says, I'm wearing Versace. You're right?
All right now.
They even ask these little boys, what are you wearing? And they say, oh, Christian Dior. Yeah, little boys! You have clothes made by the King of the Universe.
Yes. Amen.
You have the garments of praise. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
You have the garments of praise. You have the wedding garments of Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Rejoice.
Yes.
Walk worthy.
Yes.
Don't if you're wearing a Versace, are you going to go rolling the mud?
My
Lord. Well, you're wearing a Yahweh, Yeshua HaMashiach.
All right now.
You're wearing Christ Jesus, the Messiah. You're wearing God, the great I Am, the maker and finisher of our faith. You're wearing Adonai. You are wearing Jehovah Rapha, the great healer. You are wearing the name above all names. You need to walk worthy of the garments that he's given you to wear. Now, if you fall in the mud, put it in the washing machine or send it to the dry cleaners. That's the blood of Jesus.
All right, amen.
That's the blood of Jesus.
Yeah.
That's a repentant heart.
Yeah.
When you have a repentant heart and you put it in the blood of Jesus,
yes.
You ask for some shouting out, which is the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
When you get it, it's going to be white as snow, pressed and ready to wear again. Put it right back on. And then go walk worthy of the high calling. Work. All of the old fashions are now obsolete. Words like Jewish and non-Jewish, religious and irreligious, insider and outsider, uncivilized and unfruit, slave and free, meaning nothing. From now on, everyone is defined by Christ. Everyone is included in Christ.
Amen. Praise God.
What do we read in Ephesians chapter 2? That Christ himself has torn down the middle wall of partition which once separated Jew from Gentile, and out of the twain has made one new man.
Amen.
You see, there's not a God of the Old Testament and a God of the New Testament. There is one God. And there's one people of God.
Yeah.
Both Jew and Gentile are made one in Messiah.
Yes, Lord.
A lot of the Jewish people, their eyes have been blinded for a season until the fullness of the Gentiles can't come in. But they will have the scales removed from their eyes, and they will confess with their mouth the Lord Jesus. Because the word of God says, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess Jesus Christ is Lord. And those that are of his family, those who call him Abba Father, they will do so before the white throne judgment. All the rest will do it before they're condemned into the lake of fire.
Yes, amen. Praise God, praise God.
Where do you want to be?
Hallelujah.
Forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things, put on the charity, which is the bond of perfectness. Let's look at the message. So we get out of the Christianese a little bit. We get caught up in that.
Alright.
So chosen by God for this new life of love, dressed in the wardrobe of God, picked out for you, compassion, kindness, humility, quiet, strength, discipline, be even tempered.
My Lord Jesus.
Man, I have to work on that one. We're screamers in my family.
All right now.
We scream. My neighbor said, do you realize not only are you a screamer, but you stay up past midnight every night and you scream?
My Lord Jesus.
I said, I'm sorry. I'm embarrassed. I'm working on that. I'm not perfect yet.
Amen.
And sometimes I'm lazy too because we have a two-story. And my kids go upstairs and shut the doors. My children do. Well, they're not children. They're young people now. But they go upstairs and they shut the doors. And you want to come down and talk to you. And you say, hey, Matt. No answer. You know, Matt. But, so now I have to get up and go knock on the wall. Matt! 2 o'clock in the morning. You didn't do the dishes. We have days. We can't do it all. But the word of God says that I should be even tempered. Content with second place. Quick to forgive an offense. Somebody says, forgive me, say, I already did. Work hard to forgive your enemies. Choose to do it. It's hard. When somebody looks at you and the devil speaks to them and they say, you are going down. hard to remember that is someone that needs Jesus in their life, and he died on the cross for them the same as he did for you, and that now you have greater responsibility to pray over their soul.
Yes, Lord.
Because the devil revealed himself in them.
Right.
Because that person is wounded and some door opened for the devil to come in. We need to pray for them even more. We got to, when a lot of times you think you've forgiven somebody and they're out of your life for a long time, and when they come back into your life for whatever reason, all those old feelings come back up, you realize you really need to take it back to the cross of Calvary.
Amen.
You really need to see God's giving you a do-over. For some reason, you're getting another opportunity to forgive, and you're going to have to take it back to the cross of Calvary and say, I want to be like you, Jesus. I want to forgive even my enemies. I want to forgive. I want to love them the way you love me.
Man, praise God.
For as quickly and completely as the Master forgave you, and regardless of what else you put on, wear love. It's your basic all-purpose garment. Never be without it.
Man, praise
God. Do you know what people know when you're genuine? And people know when you're a phony.
Right.
There are other women and men, even in ministry, that when they're hugging me, I'm thinking to myself, I sure hope they don't have a pocket knife. Because if they do, they're going to bury it in my back.
Yeah.
You know how it is, Pastor Tao. You know when people smell at you in the face, amen? They look at you and they, oh, I love you. And you know, all along, they're thinking mean things.
All right now.
Right?
Amen.
It happens.
Amen.
But you know what? We have a greater responsibility to respond to that. With love.
Yeah.
How did Yeshua, how did Jesus respond? He went to Calvary's cross.
Yes, he did.
He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Man.
We've got to learn how to be like him.
Yeah.
I saw a man attacked in this very church, and I saw him handle the attack with humility and love, and that spoke volumes to me. Volumes. I said, that's a man of God. I don't want to be like that.
Praise the Lord.
You know, we have to forgive.
Yes,
even in the midst of the attack.
Amen.
And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him.
Amen.
Let's go to this message. So let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other, in step with each other. None of us is going off and doing your own thing. And cultivate thankfulness. Let the word of Christ, the message, have the run of the house. Give it plenty of room in our lives.
God.
Don't you want people to see Jesus in you?
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Don't you want to not have to preach the Bible but live it?
Yes.
Don't you want to say, I always feel so happy when I'm around you. Thank
yes,
you
Lord.
For showing me such love. Isn't that the testimony of Christ that you want people to feel?
Yes.
Praise God.
Let every detail in your lives, words and actions, whatever, be done in the name of the Master Jesus, thanking God the Father every step of the way. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives, and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged.
All right.
Servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service, as merely as unto the Lord, and not unto men. Now, we don't have a system of servants and slaves. That they did, but we could, in that day, that was their economy. People would take care of the servants that were their house workers, their domestic people.
Yes.
Knowing that the Lord, ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. But he that doeth wrong shall receive the wrong which he has done, and there is no respect for persons.
And
let's finish this in the message. Wives, understand and support your husbands by submitting to them in ways that honor the Master. Husbands, go all out in love for your wives. Don't take advantage of them. Children, do what your parents tell you to. This delights the Master to no end. Parents, don't come down too hard on your children. You'll crush their spirits. Servants or employees, do what you're told by your bosses, your earthly masters. And don't just do the minimum that will get you by. Do your best. Work from your heart for your real master, for God. Confident that you'll get paid in full when you come into your inheritance. Keep in mind always that the ultimate master you're serving is Christ. The sullen servant who does shoddy work will be held responsible. Being a follower of Jesus doesn't cover up bad work. You know, in my professional life, when I've been working in the real estate industry, and when I was in the title business, sometimes I would meet people that were had little fish on their card. They said they were a Christian. And they thought that meant I would act unethically with them. Okay, we're brothers in the same club, so you're going to like not charge me, so you're going to let me steal from your boss. No. You shouldn't ask for that of me, brother. You shouldn't ask me to do something wrong because we're both Christians. In fact, you and I have a higher standard. You should give my boss more than he's asking, because you should want to honor Jesus.
Yes, amen.
We have to do that way.
Amen.
We should not lower our standards because we're Christians. We have to walk higher. Amen?
God.
Well, I hope you received something from Colossians chapter 3 today.
Thank you, Lord.
I want you to know you are children of the Most High God.
Amen.
Because of the blood of Jesus, you can call him Abba. You can call him Daddy. He loves you. It's an everlasting love. But he does want you to walk worthy of that. If you haven't in the past, don't feel condemnation. Just be encouraged that God's telling you, okay, now is the time. Ask me. I'm going to give you the power. I'm going to give you the strength. I'm going to fill you with the holy boldness. And you're going to be all working. Walk worthy of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. You're going to press on to the prize. Hallelujah. And then you're going to one day come with him in the air to redeem a lost world. Give the Lord a praise. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus! Well, Father Rock is going to sing us out and close in prayer.
Hallelujah. Hush, hush. Somebody's calling my name. Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Oh my Lord, oh my Lord, what shall I do? Sound like Jesus, somebody's calling my name. Sound like Jesus. Somebody's calling my name. Sound like Jesus. Somebody's calling my name. Oh my Lord, oh my Lord, what shall I do? Hush, hush. Somebody's calling my name. Hush, hush. Somebody's calling my name. Hush, hush. Somebody's calling my name. Oh my Lord, oh my Lord, what shall I do? Run, sinner, run. Find you a hiding place. Run, sinner, run. Oh my.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 You are dismissed.